yaptı mı?
Gaven. Er zit van alles in.
Distinguished colleagues, dear audience, welcome to the 105th Dies Natalis Wageningen University and Research. Special welcome to the mayor and aldermen of Wageningen and Veenendaal municipalities, to the rectores magnifici from Dutch universities and foreign universities, to the members of the supervisory board of Wageningen University and Research, to the ambassadors and representatives from the Republic of Albania, the People's Democratic Republic of Algeria, the Republic of Armenia, Argentine Republic, the Republic of Azerbaijan, the People's Republic of Bangladesh, the Republic of Belarus, the Kingdom of Belgium, Bosnia and Herzegovina, the Republic of Burundi, Republic of Cameroon, Republic of Chile, the Republic of Costa Rica, the Republic of El Salvador, the French Republic, the Republic of Guatemala, the Republic of India, Republic of Indonesia, Islamic Republic of Iran, the State of Israel, the Republic of Kosovo, the State of Kuwait, the Kingdom of Morocco, New Zealand, the Federal Republic of Nigeria, the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, the Republic of Panama, Republic of Peru, Republic of Slovenia, Republic of South Africa, the Democratic Socialist Republic of Sri Lanka, the Republic of Sudan, the Republic of Suriname, United Republic of Tanzania, the Republic of Uganda, the Oriental Republic of Uruguay, the Socialist Republic of Vietnam, and the Republic of Yemen. Also welcome to our national and international partners, to our three honorary doctorates, soon to be honorary doctorates, and of course, last but certainly not least, to our students. The international audience, which is present here, so you, underlines the importance we and you also attach to international science cooperation and also to international students and student exchange here at Wageningen University, regardless of the sometimes hostile national debates. The audience, 105 years ago, we were established. And if we look at the organization now, we can say that we are in a very good shape. We are in a good shape research-wise. So we have excellent research, renowned all over the world, both on the applied side as well as on the fundamental side. We are in good shape in terms of education. I have to mention that also to my colleagues from the Netherlands, 18 times the best university on education. We need to get rid of that. And we are in good shape in terms of maybe most important, having an impact in the world, contributing to what we usually call the Sustainable Development Goals. But of course, our past performance does not say anything about the future. And there's much to be done in the world. If we look around us, the world is not in a good shape. So that's also why we have coined this lustrum year with a specific title, Shaping Sustainable Futures, because that is what we are standing for. Now I need some help. Major symbolic tokens are not just there, but they also represent major societal developments and also societal anxieties. This is still, some of you might recognize that, from the Avatar 2 movie, The Way of Water. The Avatar 1 movie was very much on land. The Avatar 2 movie is very much on water, on the dangers which the major oceans and sea are seeing around us. And it's back basically on what they call the resource Development Authority and what it does to the seas and oceans. And I think it stands for something. It stands for something what we see happening at the moment in our seas and oceans. So that's why we thought in the broader title of Shaping Sustainable Futures, we coined this specific Dies Natalis celebration on the marine environment, because that is also very much in danger. For that, we need also a change of perspective. Usually our normal perspective of the world here on the map, but it can be of course visualized in different ways, is where we put land very central. But there are also maps and other visualizations where indeed oceans and seas are put central. So for instance, the Spillhouse World Ocean Maps, which really put the ocean central. And that is what we try to do today. What you see is that there are a lot of activities shifting from land-based activities to sea-based activities. The seas and oceans are increasingly populated by all kinds of economic activities. And here you see, probably you cannot read it, but it's also to get the idea. Here you see on a number of major activities the movement to sea and the development at seas. And that's on the production of blue food, that's on deep sea mining, that's on tourism, that's on fishing, you name it. 12 major indicators where the horizontal line, the axis, goes from 1970 to 2020. And basically what you see is the major developments have taken place from 1990, 2000 upwards. So basically what we see is there's increasingly a use of the oceans. Let's just take one example to get a little bit deeper into that. Blue food. Blue food is the container name of all the food we are producing from basically salt water, sometimes also fresh water. There are now 2,500 species which are either caught or cultivated via agriculture, which we name blue food. It's a major source of food for 3 billion people around the world. And the demand is likely to be double in the coming 25 to 30 years. About two-thirds of the blue food is produced by small-scale fisheries and aquaculture producers. And 800 million people depend on blue food for their livelihood. If you look at it a little bit more from a sustainable angle, you see that the greenhouse gas footprint from animal proteins from blue food is much lower than that from land-based animal proteins. So there are major wins, so to say. But of course, we see also a major negative developments. So basically what we see with these major developments moving to the sea, we see that the sea and the oceans are the new frontier. The new frontier of two sets of major challenges. One challenge, which is visualized here, is very much on pollution, loss of biodiversity, a major accumulation of toxic substances in food chains in the oceans, etc. There's a major crisis going on there. The second main challenge is there where there are major conflicts taking place between states and private sectors, and also between private sectors at sea. So we need, if we want to go to a sustainable use of oceans and seas, we need blue transitions, the major title of the current Dies Natalis. And these blue transitions are not just easily happening there. We can, of course, use our knowledge, which we gained from land-based studies, and much of the land-based knowledge is very much useful also. But we also need what we could call blue knowledge to investigate the need for blue transitions, to monitor what's happening at the seas, and also to come up with solutions. And there, I think, at least I will mention four major differences between what's happening on the land and what's happening on the sea, both in terms of major crises, but also if we want to study them. So the first one is very much related to Hugo Grotius' major work in 1609. It was Mare Liberum. So the idea that the high seas are basically belonging to no one. That means also that governing the high seas is a really major and different thing than just governing land-based sources. And we've seen the major efforts which have taken us to come at the High Sea Treaty, which was just concluded 1 week ago. The second main difference between land-based and sea-based activities is that seas and oceans are largely uninhabited. They are out of sight of the ordinary people, of the citizens of the world, basically. We do not live next to deep sea mining. So we cannot witness that. So all kinds of mechanisms of NIMBY are not there in oceans and seas, which are there on territories. Third one is that oceans and sea have next to the two horizontal dimensions, which we know very well from land-based resources, also a third vertical dimension. So if we talk about spatial planning, which is so much needed and which we are experimenting upon in the North Sea area, for instance, that also requires spatial planning in the third dimension, into the deep. And that's very different from what we see on most of the land-based activities. And finally, many of the marine challenges, they flow. They are not place-based. Fish migrate, pollution moves around, ships, cargo moves around, marine tourists move around. That is, to some extent, different from what we see in oceans and sea. Here at Wageningen, we work on blue knowledge already for quite some time. We do that within our Wageningen Marine Research Institute, of course, but also in some of the other applied research institutes. We do that also within research on a more fundamental side in the university. We do that in education, in our master program on marine resources and agriculture management. But we all are also going to intensify that, going to establish, it was already on the movie, a new bachelor program in marine sciences, where we educate a new generation of so much needed marine experts, which can really look from an integral perspective at the marine and sea resources and come up with solutions to sustainable use and development and protection of marine resources. And we are, together with, amongst others, Utrecht University, also establishing a major Delta Center, Delta Climate Center in Zeeland, where for the coming 10 years at least, we will work on new solutions to cope with the major challenges of marine and deltas. Dear audience, if there's one person which can really illuminate a little bit further what it means to make sustainable use and protection of marine resources, it is our DS lecturer, Professor Beatrice Krona. Beatrice Krona is a world-renowned expert in the marine domain. She got a master in ecotoxicology and a PhD in systems ecology. At the moment, she's scientific director of the Stockholm Resilience Center, and she's also director of the research program Global Economic Dynamics and the Biosphere of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences. She worked, amongst others, in the Marine Commons, on marine and fishery governance, on fish trade and value change, and on financial mechanisms to protect the seas and oceans. May I invite Beatrice Krona to the floor to give her DS lecture.
Thank you. Sorry. Thank you for that excellent scene setting for my talk. I hope to touch on some of the issues that Rector Magnificus brought up. But I want to say first that thank you for having me. It's a slightly intimidating task to stand and give a talk in front of such a large, distinguished, and diverse audience. I don't think I ever have before. So to take the edge off it a little bit, I thought I would start with some inspirational music to set us off. Sorry to cut it short, it's quite a catchy tune. And I know some of you are probably thinking, if you came to the wrong lecture, what has Britney Spears got to do with any of blue transitions? And she doesn't, of course. And what I find inspirational about this is not the song itself. It is the man behind it. Max Martin is his name. He's a Swede, same as me, but probably someone most of you have never heard of. And he has actually co-written over 25 Billboard number one songs. And that's more than anyone in history ever. It's quite impressive. And his recipe for success is collaboration. And initially, his success stemmed from just collaborating with multiple other pop musicians or producers in and around Sweden. And that was then, back in the 90s, it still is actually today, quite unusual. Most songs get written by one, possibly two people. Later, he reinvented himself, and then his modus operandi when he became even more successful was to mix and therefore collaborate with wildly different music genres, from classical piano all the way to death metal. And it's this creative force, I think, that I admire and that I find inspirational. Because Max Martin is a living example of what researchers of creativity and innovation would call recombinatory innovation. This is something that relies on cross-pollination of ideas or technology, which happens when people from different backgrounds, music genres, or disciplines collide against each other over time to develop a truly integrated mix that becomes a new whole that is different, sometimes larger than the sum of its parts. Like the rolling suitcase. This is a combination of the technology of luggage with a wheel that combined created a very, very handy innovation, which I used when I was traveling here through the snow for 10 hours yesterday. But the last bit here about cross-pollination of ideas could actually also be a definition or a description of the inter- and transdisciplinary science that I want to talk about. Because this is a talk about the value and importance of inter- and transdisciplinary science in general, alongside, of course, the equally important deep disciplinary science on which all interdisciplinary discoveries build. And I'm not in the least suggesting that I'm anywhere near as creative or as successful as Max Martin, but it is also a talk, a brief account of a journey across disciplines, my journey, to find scientific answers to pressing societal issues, many of them relating to the ocean domain, and becoming what I would call an undisciplinary scientist. My journey started here in marine ecology, in the mangroves of southern Kenya. And blue questions have since continued to permeate most, if not all, of my work. And my undisciplinarity as a scientist became clear quite early on when I was really, as a PhD student working here, on mangrove ecology, fisheries ecology. I was struggling to stay on the purely ecological path because as I was sitting in this community where I lived, listening to fishers talk about where they fished, why they fished there, and in other places, and so I became very curious about how that knowledge affected their practices and their view of the coastal system and what that meant for local fisheries governance. And also, as I watched the seasonal inflows of migrant fishermen coming up from Tanzania, impacting these local communities, impacting the landings, the markets, I began to realize that if I wanted to contribute to sustainability in this region, I was going to have to branch out and become a bit more diverse in my approach. So I turned to sociology. And with a PhD colleague of mine, we ended up systematically collecting social network data that would allow us to understand who was communicating ecological understanding and knowledge with each other, but also who was exchanging gear or using gear and also trading with each other. And this became the empirical foundation that allowed us to eventually start to use sociological methods and theories to explore a number of issues that have all have bearing on the governance of the marine and coastal resources in that region. And just as an example, the knowledge networks that you see here to the top right indicated the existence of a set of highly central individuals in this knowledge sharing network. And individuals that occupy such central positions in a knowledge sharing network can be really instrumental in determining which knowledge and which interpretation of what you're seeing around you, in this case, the ecological signals, becomes most dominant. So we often refer to them as opinion leaders. Now, if these same opinion leaders have the power over, for example, gear, which gear is used and how, then they can become very influential with regards to resource use and resource decision making. And the lower figure you see here is a network of gear exchange among the villagers. And when we combine these networks and analyze them together, we could see that powerful individuals were overrepresented among those to whom fishers would go to discuss ecological dynamics. And even more interesting was the fact that we found that the most central and influential individuals tended to also be these seasonal migrants, which our previous knowledge, or my knowledge of that, showed were the group that had the least holistic understanding of this ecological system. Why? Because, well, they largely fished with larger boats outside of the reef crests and not in the lagoon. But also, they only spent a few months in this system every year. And because of that, their interest in sustainability and long-termism of the system was also much different and much lower. And this is just an example of how the new combination of data and theories and methods, for at least for us, we were able to contribute a better understanding of the combined effect of multiple social relations for marine resource governance in this region, and start to uncover factors that were actually, yes, facilitating, but also hindering this community from transforming its practices. And even though it began as two PhD students that were merely sort of dabbling, you could say, with sociological methods and theories and experimenting on how to apply them, the work actually ended up sparking the emergence of a new academic field in the intersection of environmental resource governance and sociology, and now enjoys its own standard session at this international annual conference on social network and quantitative sociology, the Sunbelt Conference that you see up there. And I mention this only to show that even as young scholars, you can, by experimenting, initiate bigger things that you don't even think about when you're doing it. And it's sort of a result of this recombinatory innovation that I referred to at the start. But the deeper understanding of social relations also sparked my own personal interest in the importance of understanding trade relationships and, yeah, trade for governance of ocean resources and their sustainability. Because multiple places that have been historically driven by largely local forces are now increasingly affected by drivers at multiple scales, often international. And trade is particularly important in driving change. And as we heard Rector Magnificus mention already before, seafood is now exported into internationally more than ever. In fact, at the bottom picture shows there, it's a bit hard to see, I can see, but roughly half of the global export value of foods comes from aquatic systems now. And this ignited the next phase in my journey, which began by examining the effects of indebtedness on resource use and behavior. Debt and trade, what's the connection? Well, debt among fishers in small-scale fisheries, but probably in large-scale ones as well, is a key driving factor behind how people behave. And it's very common in small-scale fisheries for fishermen to be indebted and for middlemen to play the key role here, because it is to them that most of the fishers are in debt. And by leveraging this debt, middlemen end up actually directing effort and sort of affecting which gears get used and which species get targeted. So by examining the debt-tying relationships in fishing communities, we began to try to uncover the role that these middlemen were playing in influencing resource extraction by, as I said, leveraging the debt. And we can see it in this picture. It's a bit hard to see, but I've highlighted there in yellow, showing the percentage of what we call predetermined sales of fishermen. And many of them basically perceiving that they are locked into these sales relationships and they have no ability to change them. And the research really just ended up showing the importance of recognizing this, what we call the ignored link in fisheries and ocean, not ocean, but coastal governance here, between fishers and downstream markets. The middlemen, they represent that ignored link. And just a call to include them much more explicitly in fisheries governance and regulatory policies. And as I studied traders and fishermen in Kenya and Tanzania and the Swahili coast, I became also more and more curious about the effect of global markets and local communities elsewhere. Because when small-scale fisheries are integrated into global markets, the local social ecological systems in which they're embedded start to change. And that can have both positive and negative effects. But back a few years ago when we were starting, I couldn't find any studies that had systematically tried to investigate why the outcomes of that market integration looked so different in different places. Most likely, actually, because it was a really hard thing to do and it was very time-consuming. But as we were trying, anyway, the first obstacle was to try and find a way to analyze change in complex social ecological systems. And, of course, when we want to understand change in systems, we can't simply rely on the same methods or approaches as when we're examining causal links between individual variables. Like, for example, you see here fishing effort and fixed stock size. Because analysis of single facets of change are never in themselves going to provide a very good or accurate understanding of the multifaceted nature of change in a social ecological system, for example. System change, instead, is the result of a complex set of factors that interacts to produce a particular set of outcomes. And Schellenhuber, back in 97, but then later Lüdicke, developed this global environmental change syndromes as an approach to overcome this tendency for single-facet sectoral approaches to understanding change. They argue that bundles of interacting processes can be grouped into these syndromes of change. I was very inspired by that, and we ended up drawing on this approach to systematically assess the combination of economic, social, institutional, and ecological outcomes of market integration in small-scale fisheries from around the world. And what we did was identify basically 18 cases where we had enough deep and sort of holistic data to look at it. We identified three distinct clusters among these cases around the world. And they represented then small-scale fisheries that basically share a set of similar set of outcomes. In other words, they're clusters that represent social ecological syndromes. And they can provide an indication of how a local seafood system actually interacts with global trade to deliver a particular set of outcomes. I'm not going to get into detail here, but one syndrome was associated with mostly positive outcomes in the form of sustainable levels of fishing. But two of the other ones were not. They were characterized by declining stocks and social conflicts, for example, or elite capture by downstream actors. And without going again into the details, I think the notable thing here is that we see no geographic pattern in the occurrence of the syndromes. They're globally occurring. And what it means is that, or, you know, regardless if we're looking at South America, in this case, Africa, India, you can see those red dots up there. And it means that you find markets, small-scale fisheries that are market integrated across those different continents, but they're all grappling with the same type of outcomes. And it suggests that international trade is driving local dynamics in ways that create very similar conditions, very similar outcomes and vulnerabilities in localities around the world. And it can help us look at what those factors are and then look how to address them in a context-specific way. So that was a very brief synopsis of sort of the first 15 years of my academic career. And it's been a really windy journey that has been driven more by a desire to have relevant answers to pressing societal issues than to have perhaps dig deep and perfect specific methods. I have forged my career on collaboration with countless disciplinary experts. And it's only by combining that expertise that we have been able to deliver some of the insights that I've been fortunate to kind of contribute to. And as a very recent example of that, I want to mention the Blue Food Assessment. Because I had the honor of co-chairing this scientific international assessment, which examines the role of blue foods and that blue foods can play in the, at least according to us, much needed transformation of the food system towards something that is more just, equitable, healthy, and that doesn't undermine the planet. This assessment brought together scientists from more than 25 institutions
to study blue foods from multiple different sort of deep disciplinary angles. And my co-host here today, Professor Simon Bush, was one of these colleagues. And the assessment is made up of 9 papers and spans multiple domains that are all critical, I think, if you want to try and understand and influence change in food systems. It ranges from nutrition and environmental performance, of course, but also demand for aquatic foods now and potential in the future, as well as justice and equity issues that are of importance to the diverse community of primarily small-scale actors who produce the majority of the blue foods that we actually consume as humans around the world. And together, these blue food papers have shown that, broadly speaking, blue foods can play 4 roles in the transformation of our food systems. Or maybe I should say, actually, that they can help achieve 4 broad policy objectives that relate to several important SDGs, like hunger, like health, environment, poverty. And one objective, we argue, is to reduce nutrient deficiencies. And blue foods can be really useful there because many of them are very dense in micronutrients and even small amounts. I was requested to do a review for Nature Communications as late as yesterday that shows that even small amounts consumed of, for example, forage fish by humans can massively increase the nutritional status of particularly vulnerable populations. But a second objective could be to reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease. And by replacing some of the red, particularly processed meat, if we do that, replacing that with aquatic foods, then we could actually help reduce that risk as well. We have large carbon footprints in some parts of the world, so reducing the carbon footprints that are associated with our food consumption and production is another role that blue foods can play, particularly if we can substitute some of the terrestrial high-impactful red meat with low-impact aquatic foods. And the fourth one would be to safeguard contributions to economies and livelihoods under a changing climate. Why? Because aquatic foods are tremendously diverse. We heard Rector Magnificus before mentioning 2,500 species is what we farm or catch in the wild around the world. That's a tremendous diversity. And it's in that diversity that we see the potential for the resilience of not only the aquatic food systems, but also the food systems at large, in the face of a changing climate and changing other changing environmental conditions. And in this paper that came out in Nature actually as recently as a couple of weeks ago, the Blue Food Assessment team has tried to synthesize this. And we assessed the degree of relevance of each of these policy objectives across nations based on what's nationally available data. In the maps here, it's suffice to say that the darker the color, the more relevant a particular objective is for that nation, based on nationally available data, as I said. And just to give you a sense of how one might want to interpret this is that we can see that, for example, in many African nations, facilitating blue food consumption, especially among nutritionally vulnerable populations, could really help address vitamin B and 12 and omega-3 deficiencies. Meanwhile, in the global north, we're struggling with high risks of cardiovascular disease in some places, and many of our nations are struggling with large carbon footprints. And this is where transitioning to lower carbon diets via perhaps some substitution of the red meat with low impact aquatic foods could really be a useful option. But overall, the framework that we propose is really to help decision makers think about and assess the blue food policy objectives that are most relevant to their geographies, and then provide also this interactive tool that I'm not going to go through here, but if you're interested, you can have a look. Instead, I want to move on, because I've spoken a lot now about food, but food is only one of an increasing number of benefits that we as a society are looking to the ocean, and here you get the ocean-centric map again. We are looking to the ocean to provide. And the term the blue economy has gained immense traction, reflecting the enormous commercial interest in and efforts devoted to claiming ocean resources and space. I And here we go again. This graph is actually published by Jean-Baptiste Jouvray, who is my PhD student, in an effort to try and show this. And I think the figure captures it really well. We see, as we've already seen, the exponential increase in the extraction and use of ocean resources since the 1970s across so many different sort of ocean sectors, from aquaculture up there to submarine cables to cruise tourism, to mention a few different ones. But what is the blue economy? What does it mean? It's been repackaged, conceptualized to match a diversity of discourses that are anchored in quite specific geographies or linked to the experience of specific industries or sectors. Some of these, and many actually, I would say, see natural capital as a foundation for business development. We can see that reflected, for example, quite strongly in groups such as the UN Global Compact Ocean Action Platform, where I've been partly involved. But we also see other ways of thinking about it, such as seeing the blue economy as a means of development for small island states and small-scale livelihoods. And this last point, I think, reflects more a concern for socially equitable development of the ocean. But I would say that this view is far from the ubiquitous way that we tend to be talking about the blue economy. And instead, I think, from where I sit, I hear more of the sort of aspirational discussions of the blue economy and the blue frontier. More for everyone and positive outcomes. And I think that's not unproblematic, because as we also heard earlier, we see a rapid expansion in the industrial activities in the ocean, and it continues to outpace global regulatory efforts, generating negative consequences for local communities, for small-scale operators, and for the ocean environment, but also for the sectors themselves. And the mounting pressure on a limited marine environment is essentially, I think, resulting in two types of conflicts. It's a user-environment conflict that then result in cumulative and aggregate environmental impacts that do end up undermining the natural capital base on which everyone depends, but also user-user conflicts that result simply from the incompatibility of many ocean sectors and the foregone opportunity for one sector in the wake of another. So a couple of years ago, we set out to systematically assess scientifically the scientifically documented evidence that exists out there on interactions between economically important sectors in the ocean, and also how these interactions are mediated by the change in the natural environment. We reviewed well over 3,000 articles and developed a database and, again, an interactive tool to try and visualize this, which you see here. I'm not going to go into it because I can't show it dynamically, but if we look at all these interactions between these 14 ocean sectors that we reviewed all at once, it looks like this. So it's a bit messy. It's a bit daunting to look at, but I think that's the whole point. It indicates the complexity of the situation and the fact that in any exploitation of ocean resources will, by one sector, will have many, both positive but also negative, effects on other sectors. And this is something that we too often forget to discuss. A key insight from this analysis was that the outcomes of ocean sector interactions go actually far beyond mere spatial conflicts. Because spatial conflicts are, and we heard this before, that they are quite well addressed already with zoning, marine spatial planning, at least in exclusive economic zones. And of course, our analysis also showed that spatial overlap is huge, and it is a big thing that we need to address, but I'm not going to dwell on it here because a lot of work is already being done on that. Instead, I want to flag some of the other outcomes that we saw. For example, the fact that by virtue of simply their practices, many sectors affect each other's operations. For example, trawling accidentally snags cables. This is quite frequent of various sorts, but also dredging and mining, creating turbid waters that then affects aquaculture, fishing, tourism. Of course, you see positive effects as well. Like, for example, having cold ironing of ships out at sea as a result of renewable energy, wind parks, as an example. Another outcome includes impacts on tourism or touristic value. And we're seeing an increasing number of studies to show that actually there's sometimes some positive spillover effect between wind farms and tourism. Remains to see how long that will last, but mostly, unfortunately, we see negative effects from physical or visual pollution from, for example, aquaculture, ports, or different kinds of mining. But I think the impact on the natural capital, on which another sector depends, is by far the most common outcome with big impacts on other sectors that we see from this study, at least. And I think it's quite intuitive to think that almost, of course, any sector that's operating in the ocean is going to have some sort of environmental impact. But what the review shows is the magnitude of the combined direct and indirect effects that this causes for other sectors. And analytically, we can see it clearly in a figure like this, where each circle represents a sector. And in a network diagram like this, the size of a node is a reflection of how many interactions it has. And the key thing I want you to focus on here is simply the size of the sector that's termed biosphere, that represents the marine environment, which is among the biggest in this graph, which means it is involved in interactions with pretty much every single sector. And the review shows that the cumulative nature of environmental impacts with implications over long timescales often. Of course, there will be ecological impacts that reverse themselves without any real remedial action. But there also, we've seen some incidents with long-term widespread effects, like the BP Deep Horizon from 2010, which you all recall, I'm sure. But then there's also countless others, like pollution, biodiversity, and habitat loss, that may initially, when you look at them, look like they have quite small localized effects or impacts, but are all often cumulative and exert this aggregate pressure over time, undermining the natural resource base. And evidence from this study shows that certain ocean sectors are particularly likely to incur a mix of these local, but over time, cumulative impacts. Of course, any conflict over the use of natural resources or space is going to have winners and losers. But what this work could show really clearly, and what I think is really important to keep in mind, is that access to space is biased. And it's often biased on historical presence, on size, on current economic influence. And it risks leading to an unequal ability among ocean sectors in the now to develop the ocean space. Unfortunately, I think the ocean governance landscape is not really well equipped to deal with the full range of these trade-offs, but also the opportunities. And I think we need to be much more open and explicit about the fact that user-user conflicts, and those go beyond just the spatial crowding, and the fact that these will arise largely as a result of the user-environment conflicts. So grounded in this analysis, we therefore proposed, perhaps naively, I don't know, but a set of principles. But they're essentially questions that can be posed to guide strategic decision-making as governing actors are planning for the future of our oceans. The first one, if you can see it up here, is what I think we most commonly focus on, the economics. But that's why I think it's so important to not forget to ask the other questions about sustainability. Like, to what degree an ocean sector that's vying for access actually enhances or erodes ecosystem health, or enhances or erodes the potential for future use. But we also need to consider equity. So consider whether a sector creates synergies or pushes out small-scale actors, whether it prevents new actors from gaining access, or if it creates synergies, actually, or at least low-cost options for future innovations or actors to enter the ocean space. Now, most sectors and actors are going to be somewhere along that spectrum, ranging from the red to the green. And in any decision situation regarding ocean use, you can think and use these, kind of like a deliberative tool. For example, whether to allow continued appropriation of space or resources by an incumbent actor. Just take oil and gas for case of example. Or whether new entrants, like renewable energy, as an example, should be enjoy prioritized access. So helping to make explicit and evaluate potential costly trade-offs, but also flag up opportunities for synergies when you're making decisions. Of course, the analysis of the sector interactions and the impacts and the tool that I've showed here, that is based on empirical work, scientific studies. But I recognize that when you were to use something like this, it would directly feed into the political domain and the much bigger topic of blue transitions and how we shape the marine environment now and into the future based on the decisions that we are making today. And with that, I want to wrap up because I think my 30 minutes are up. And in these 30 minutes, I've tried to trace a journey which at first glance may have seemed very epistemologically eclectic, but which I hope at a slightly more scrutiny illustrates what I would call deliberate undisciplinarity. While I think, of course, disciplinary science is important, I hope I can convey that, there's also so many intersections between established fields that I do think need to be explored if we're going to find innovative solutions to the challenges that we're facing. And this keynote was a tribute to all the disciplinary giants that I have been fortunate to work with and to learn from, but also to the next generation of undisciplinary researchers who are needed, I think, to work at the interface and the boundaries and do science that can feed into this hybrid space between science and policy, science and practice, science and business, science and society. So effectively being the Max Martins of science. So with that, I'll thank Wageningen University for inviting me to speak at this lustrum, to Rector Magnificus specifically, and to all of you for listening.
Thank you very much, Beatrice, for your lecture and showing us the need for crossing disciplines and the power of crossing disciplines without disregarding disciplinary research. I think that's the key message. We need them both in order to get better knowledge on what's happening in the oceans and also to provide knowledge for a more sustainable blue future, so to say. Thank you very much. I would now like to go to maybe a little bit lighter subjects, although this was also quite digestible, I would say, which is an intermezzo. Let me introduce the Vocal Group 12 to you. The Vocal Group 12 was founded in 2016, and it's a group, it says so, of a cappella musicians, which won in 2022 the first prize of the renowned singing festival Top in Rotterdam. They perform for us two pieces. The first one is a spherical song, Dobbin's Flowery Veil, composed by Rajaton, and the second one is a more subdued song, To the Water, by Matt Simons. And to also for you, those of you who wonder why did we invite them, besides that they are excellent musicians, they are also Wageningen students performing in that. Please, Group Vocal 12.
Ooh. Close my eyes, steady and hold tight. I'm gonna be crossing over to heaven and the great divide, and I'm ready to close my eyes, heavy and so wide. I can feel it pull me under, steady as the rising tide. Take me to the water, by the road that leads you down.
I'm ready to close my eyes, steady and hold tight. I'm gonna be crossing over to heaven and a great divide, and
I'm ready to close my eyes, heavy and so wide. I can feel it pull me under, steady and around. Take me to the water, by the road that leads you down. Take me to the water, and scatter me around. Take me to the water, by the road that leads you down. Take me to the water.
Thank you, Vocal Group 12, for your fantastic performance. Very much appreciated. The audience, those of you who are more often at the Dies Natalis in Wageningen University and Research, know that we always have, know that we always have a couple of young, what we call young scientists, and the young is of course always relative, and then, well, for this time, the Rector Magnificus is the standard, so at least younger than me. And we have that again. So may I ask to the floor Marina Strokal and Joshua Wambugu. I will introduce them first, both, and then I'll leave the stage and they will do their presentations. So I'll start with the first one, Marina. Marina Strokal is an assistant professor at the Water Systems and Global Change Group here at Wageningen University in Research. She leads a team of master's students and PhD candidates who are developing interdisciplinary models for global and national analysis. She's also a member of the Wageningen Young Academy. And Joshua Wambugu is a PhD candidate at the Wageningen Marine Animal Ecology Group. He has been a member of the Student Council before. We had some nice interactions also on that, Joshua, during his master's studies on tourism here at Wageningen University. And now he's still a member of our inclusivity working group there. Marina, I think we start with you. Floor is yours.
Let me take you on a journey from upstream down the river where I used to swim. It was the Black Sea, the coast of Crimea. I went there when I was young. The sea was blue and clean. It was great. Today, the sea is polluted because rivers bring a lot of plastics, nutrients, and chemicals into the sea. As a result, marine systems also suffer from this pollution. Why does this pollution happen? Where does it come from? And what are the solutions? My research is about answering these questions. Before we go to the place where I used to swim, let's make a detour and look at other rivers on Earth. You are looking at a map with more than 10,000 rivers. Impressive, right? I study all of them. And with my great team, we develop computer models for them, called Marina, not after me, but after the marine systems that receive pollution from these rivers. Let's see what those models tell about these rivers. Here is another map, now with two colors. The red color shows rivers that are much more polluted today than others. These rivers are located in North America, Europe, Asia, and individual catchments across the globe. These rivers have much higher quantities of plastics, painkillers, nutrients, and other chemicals. Many of these pollutants come from cities. In cities, sewage systems, which are essentially pipes, collect waste from our streets and toilets. Sometimes this waste goes to treatment facilities and sometimes doesn't. As a result, sewage pipes can discharge all kinds of pollutants into our rivers. At some moment, these pollutants also enter seas. Let's stop here for a second and have a look at the map again. The red colors, the heavily polluted areas, are home to over two-thirds of our global population. These areas call for actions today to avoid future pollution. But before we continue our journey, the question is, what actions should we take and how? Now, let's continue our journey toward, believe it or not, an optimistic future. A future in which two-thirds of our population will live in pollution-free areas with clean waters. Future projections inform us that by the end of the 21st century, many people will live in urban areas, which means more urban pollution we expect. And we want to avoid that. The good news is that we can avoid up to 95% of urban pollution in many rivers on Earth. Let's have a look where. Here is another map, similar to the one before, but now we are in the year 2100. And we see different colors. Areas that used to be red are now blue. Blue means less urban pollution and much cleaner rivers, which is the good news for people living in those areas. Unfortunately, many African rivers are red in the year 2100, implying more pollution is expected. Let me explain why. Imagine you are in an optimistic future with many cities, many sewage pipes collecting waste. Most of this waste is treated with the best technologies such as recovery techniques, constructed wetlands, and other nature-based solutions. However, for Africa, this might not be enough because the current socioeconomic projections tell us that the African population is expected to grow much faster than in other world regions. Many more people means much more waste that might be challenging to reduce to the level of today. These are, of course, model projections, but they give a strong signal to act today to avoid future pollution. Back to our journey. We have traveled across the globe. Now it is time to arrive at the place where I used to swim. When I was in school, I used to go to the Black Sea with my twin sister Vita. We were trained to swim professionally. At that time, the sea was clean. Now it has many pollution problems. Therefore, with my team here and my sister, who is a scientist in Ukraine, we projected an optimistic future in which the sea is blue again. We took microplastics as an example. And in this future, rivers will export almost 85% fewer microplastics into the sea in 2050. To get there, we need three actions. One, start implementing the best available technologies that are, for example, developed right here at Wageningen University. Two, halve consumption of non-sustainable products such as plastics. Three, avoid waste on our streets. These three actions will reduce pollution not only with microplastics in the Black Sea, but also with other chemicals and pollutants in other seas on Earth. This will take us closer to a sustainable future in which the seas are blue again. Thank you for joining me on this journey. It does not stop here, it will continue in our new Bachelor of Marine Sciences program, which I'm proud to join as a teacher. With our students, we will explore more optimistic futures. These futures will motivate us to act today to shape our sustainable marine systems.
Thank you very much. Marina has taken us through a journey from the land to the ocean. It is a time to dive into the ocean and discover what is under the beautiful blue waters. But first, I would like to tell you an inspiring story about myself. I grew up in the countryside, in the western slopes of the Abadea Ridges, in the central part of Kenya. The surrounding environment was very beautiful. The nearby Marewa River, which is the main source of Lake Naivasha, some of you might be familiar with. The beautiful forest birds, the shy black and white Corbus monkeys entertaining us with their speedy jump from tree to tree. This experience is so fresh because it is what introduced me to the love of nature. And even it's more interesting because 2 days ago, I celebrated my 40th birthday. And I took a moment to reflect about my journey, growing up in my village, heading out to the busy street of Nairobi, and then transitioning to Wageningen University almost 7 years ago, and conducting research that is well connected with today's theme, blue transition. But some of you, or many of you in this audience, are wondering, why is it important for us to think or care about sustainable future? I'll tell you why. Our oceans are made of unique ecosystems, and one of these ecosystems is coral reefs. Coral reefs are the world's most diverse biodiversity that support the livelihood of the coastal community with nutrient sources from the subsistence fishers and ecotourism activities. However, 50% of coral reefs are already dead. And the remaining half are declining at a worrying rate. And if no action is taken, 80% of the remaining living corals may disappear by 2050. What does that mean? This jeopardizes the future of over 3 billion people who are highly dependent on these marine and coastal resources. And even more, over 200 million people who are directly or indirectly employed in these marine fisheries and tourism sector. Well, I'm not here to give you a story of doom, because there is hope. Coral reef restoration is one of marine-based conservation practice that has become popular, that aims at restoring the degraded reefs and accelerating their recovery. This practice has created bright spots all over the world, where enthusiasts, marine scientists, local communities are actively involved in this very young science of reef restoration. And I'm sure most of you are wondering, what is this coral reef restoration? I would like to take you on a tour of a coral reef restoration that takes us to Mukwiro, a small fishing village on Wasini Island on the south coast of Kenya and near the northern border of Tanzania. Here, the local community represented by Beach Management Unit are actively involved in restoring the degraded reef using artificial reef structures. The artificial reef structures are built on land, designed in different shapes, and later on are deployed in specific zones. These are the community-managed area. This work is done by the local people who are trained with diving and restoration skills as reef rangers. When they go diving, they collect or they harvest. They harvest the corals of opportunity. And what are these corals of opportunity? These are coral fragments that are still alive and are lying on the seabed. They collect these coral fragments, and then they put them or nurture them in the coral nurseries. And there they are, they take about 6 to 1 year. And depending on the prevailing condition, they are expected to be ready for outplanting. They are outplanted to the artificial reef structures, and they are expected to create an amazing artificial reefs that will reattract new fish species and marine life, and eventually creating nice spillover effect for subsistence fishers and even more diving sites for tourism or ecotourism activity. It is within this coral reef restoration project that my PhD research is anchored in, looking into the societal or social dimension of coral reef restoration. And in our recent finding, we've been able to identify different categories of stakeholders who are involved in this process, as you can see in this graphic, whereby we have the government who are critical in making the policies and registrations. We have the funding agencies that are very important in creating or in providing financial support. We have the knowledge and research institute that are important in creating knowledge through research and providing technical skills. We have the tourism and business community that are important in providing the goodwill. We have the civil society organization, the local and international NGOs that are key in lobbying and advocacy. And of course, we have the critical local community who are the host. It is even more intriguing because over time, the involvement of this engagement has changed over time, complemented by diverging, but even converging expectations and motivation. What has this created is it has created a complex stakeholder network and interaction. What this interaction means? It means the communities or the stakeholders can be able to act together towards marine stewardship for the bright future. But the findings do not stop here, because the ocean will continue facing big threats. But what do we need to do to achieve that blue transition future? We can at least do three things. One, we must ensure that there is inclusiveness among the stakeholders, because this is what brings about the sense of belonging. And through inclusiveness, we are able to build a unified goals that brings about equitable benefits for all. Number two, we need to cultivate and secure social trust among these stakeholders, because it is with social trust you are able to be in a dialogue together. And lastly, and not least, we must be able to create conservation intervention that are locally embedded, that cares about sustainable marine futures. With that, we can be able to be sure that our marines, our ocean, are in good hands. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marina and Joshua, for your contributions to the theme of sustainable marine resource and the preservation of that. Distinguished colleagues, esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, a part of the celebration of this Dies Natalis may be seen as a special academic ceremony. As part of its rostrum, Wageningen University confers honorary doctorates on three eminent scientists who, be it in different areas and in different ways, have made major contributions to science and society in areas important to Wageningen University and research. I would now like to ask the mace bearer to bring forward the honorary doctors and also the honorary professors to the stage. That are Professor Baldocchi, Professor Truet, and Professor Verstraeten as the three honorary doctors and the honorary co-promoters which accompany them, Professor Vila, Professor Reinaerts, and Professor Fritz Moore. Sorry, forgot your name for a moment. I would first like to start to confer the honorary doctorate on Professor Baldocchi.
The only way of tackling the challenges of climate change is by crossing disciplines. Professor Baldocchi has created a school of scientists that share this vision. My name is Jordi Vila. I'm professor of meteorology and meteorology of air quality at Wageningen University, with a strong interest of the interaction between the biosphere and the atmosphere. We have therefore nominated Professor Baldocchi, professor of biometeorology, for the honor doctorate degree. Professor Baldocchi's vision is based on think global and act global locally. Think global because Professor Baldocchi's legacy for more than 10 years has been the leadership and coordinate of the FluxNet network station. These are 900 stations very similar to this one all around the world that they are monitoring the exchange of energy, water and greenhouse gases. This is fundamental and crucial for the understanding and monitoring of climate change. Act globally because Professor Baldocchi has pioneered on the use of the instrument, the eddy covariance instrument over there, that measures this exchange of these fluxes. The Meteorology and Air Quality Group investigates the physics, dynamics and composition under present conditions and under conditions of climate change. We are very much interested to relate the weather, air quality and climate to life and environment. Professor Baldocchi is an inspiration for us on how to cross the disciplines of atmospheric physics, atmospheric composition, and biology.
Professor Baldocchi and honorary promoter, Professor Vila, may I ask you to step forward, please? The Academic Board of Wageningen University, represented by Director Magnificus, has taken notice of your work and the importance thereof for science and society worldwide, and is aware of its impact on the scientific fields of Wageningen University and research, has decided to confer on you, Dennis David Badocki, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa, and to grant to you all rights and privileges ensuing from this honorary doctorate by law and custom. I now invite the honorary promoter, Professor Vila, to acquit himself of his duty. Professor Vila.
You have heard the decision of the Academic Board of Wageningen University to confer on you, Professor Dennis David Badocki, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa. It is now my honor to present you with the degree signed by the Rector Magnificus and the promoter and sealed with the Great Seal of Wageningen University. And as a visible token of the honorary doctorate, you will also receive an accompanying cap.
We need to take pictures also of these famous moments. I would now like to give the floor to Professor Badocki. Please.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much. Rector Magnificus for this distinct honor, and to the Wageningen University for doing this. I'm very grateful to Jordi Vila and Wouter Peters for my nomination, and I've had wonderful interactions with Wageningen University over the many years with many colleagues through Fluxnet and other things, and I learned so much from some of your earlier professors, De Witt and others, so it's been a wonderful place for a foundation. And coming from Berkeley and Davis, we're ag schools, and we're all kind of brothers and sisters, and we have similar missions of trying to feed the world in a more sustainable, healthier way, and hope we can do it. So I say, go Bears for us from Berkeley. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Badocki and Professor Vila. And once again, congratulations, Professor Badocki, for a well-deserved honorary doctorate. I would now proceed to confer the honorary doctorate on Professor Trouet.
Everybody loves tree rings. The pattern of tree rings tells the story of a tree's life, and it's the easiest way to get people, especially children, interested in tree growth. Valérie Trouet is an exceptional scientific storyteller, linking observations on changes in tree growth to climate and to society. I'm Frits Mooren, Professor of Forest Ecology and Forest Management, and with great pleasure, I have nominated Professor Valérie Trouet for an honorary doctorate's degree. As a climatologist at the University of Arizona, Valérie Trouet studies tree rings to understand the impact of changing ecological conditions on trees and on human civilizations. Tree ring research tells us about historical wood use through dating of shipwrecks, buildings, and for example, panel paintings, and also has been crucial for climate reconstruction. Valérie Trouet has taken the empirical correlation between tree rings and climate further by linking tree rings to global circulation patterns, which helps to understand the occurrence of extreme climatic events such as drought and hurricanes. The methods Valérie develops are also applied in our Denver lab here in Wageningen. Valérie is able to raise interest in climate change and the role of trees and forests by building bridges from fundamental small-scale phenomena in trees to large-scale processes of atmosphere and climate. I admire her for doing such fundamental research and at the same time conveying her curiosity and her enthusiasm to her students and to the general public.
Professor Trouet and honorary promoter, Professor Mooren, may I ask you to step forward, please? The Academic Board of Wageningen University, represented by Director Magnificus, having taken notice of your work and the importance thereof for science and society worldwide, and being aware of its impact on the scientific fields of Wageningen University and research, has decided to confer on you, Valérie Trouet, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa, and to grant to you all rights and privileges ensuing from this honorary doctorate by law and custom. I now invite the honorary promoter, Professor Moore, to acquit himself of his duty. Professor Moore.
You've heard the decision of the Academic Board of Wageningen University to confer on you, Professor Valérie Trouet, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa. It is now my honor to present you with the degree signed by the Rector Magnificus and the promoter and sealed with the Great Seal of Wageningen University. As a visible token of this honorary doctorate, you will also receive an accompanying kappa.
And again, pictures are needed. Stay there. And of course, you get the floor, Professor Trouet.
Thank you so much, Rector Magnificus, and everyone here. It's never in my wildest dreams, I kid you not, did I think I would stand here at Wageningen University and receive this honor. And it's all due to the efforts of my phenomenal colleagues, Professor Fritz Moore, Professor Ute Zas-Klaassen and Pieter Zuidema, who unfortunately can't be here. I'd like to thank all of you. Really, it's my biggest honor. I'd also like to thank my mentors, Hans Beekman, who knows better what I should do in my career than I do myself, Jan Esper, Alan Taylor, Tom Swetnam, my peers who have been here with me since the very start of my career, Christophe Haneke and Marta Dominguez Delmas. My research group, of course, none of this would have been possible without the very talented and hardworking people in my group. My parents, who've allowed me to carve the career path that I wished. And last but certainly not least, my husband, Will Peterson, you're my rock. And without you, none of this would have happened, I swear. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Trouet and Professor Moore. And once again, congratulations, Professor Trouet, on a well-deserved honorary doctorate. Finally, I want to confer the degree, the honorary doctorate, on Professor Verstraeten, who, just by accident, was also a teacher of the former honorary doctorate.
Microorganisms are abundantly present all around us, and we must not fight against them, but work with them. Willy Verstraeten has been a passionate advocate of the concept of microbial resource management as the road to a sustainable and healthy world. For his contributions to that, on behalf of my colleagues here in Wageningen, Wetzes, and the universities of Delft and Kent, I have nominated Emeritus Professor Willy Verstraeten to award him an honorary doctorate degree. The first of Willy's lectures I remember and joined back in the 80s was revolutionary. He anchored this basic idea of the omnipresence and activity of microorganisms in my mind and triggered a new way of thinking, which is still the base of my work today as professor at Wageningen. We are now in Bennekom and we see this 100 years old activated sludge technology still used worldwide to clean our toilet and industrial waters, but in an unsustainable way. Willy showed that we can use microorganisms in soil and water to sequester carbon and nitrogen and thus mitigate our climate and nutrient crisis. And together with Katze Lettinga from Wageningen, he developed anaerobic biotechnologies to convert waste organics into green gas, helping us in our energy transition. changing all these systems into facilities where microorganisms produce sustainable solutions is an inspiring challenge Willy gave to us scientists to work with.
Professor Verstraeten and honorary promoter Professor Reinaerts, may I ask you to step forward, please. The Academic Board of Wageningen University, represented by Director Magnificus, having taken notice of your work and the importance thereof for science and society worldwide, and being aware of its impact on the scientific fields of Wageningen University and research, has decided to confer on you, Willy Verstraeten, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa, and to grant to you all rights and privileges ensuing from this honorary doctorate by law and custom. I now invite the honorary promoter, Professor Reinaerts, to acquit himself of his duty. Professor Reinaerts.
You have heard the decision of the Academic Board of Wageningen University to confer on you, Professor Willy Verstraeten, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa. It is now my honor to present you with the degree signed by Director Magnificus and the promoter and sealed with the Great Seal of Wageningen University. And as a visible token of this honorary doctorate, you will also receive an accompanying kappa.
Yes. We do one more thing.
It proved to be a real diploma, after all. I would like to give the floor to you, Professor Verstraeten, for a few words.
Mr. Rector, standing here in front of this beautiful hall in the Mecca of life sciences worldwide, and having heard that choir and being fond of singing, I have the desire not to speak, but to start singing that beautiful Mozart aria in dieser heiligen Hallen. Wouldn't that be beautiful? But I don't have the time. Thank you to this, my utmost thanks to this institution and to all who have been instrumental to bestow this honors upon me. But I like also to touch base for 1 second with the previous generation. I was born after the Second World War in a small farm, and my parents gave me all the possibilities to study. Thanks. I had super teachers throughout my education. Unbelievably important. Thanks. I turn now to the current generation. Again, first to my family for all the support and the comprehension. And then again to that institution, the university, that I could work and develop and find all those warmth and that cooperation and that resonance. And to be in contact with students, what a marvelous thing this is. And then to suddenly find that somebody you could teach to gets at the same site and at the same moment the honorary degree. Beautiful. But I also like then to thank all my worldwide colleagues, which make you vibrate in the system that you work and which keep you moving forward. And many are here. Thank you very much for that. But to finish, I turn to that new generation. To be here at the university, you feel that they understand that there is a lot to do, that some of the things we did were not all that perfect, but that they are willing to take over and continue. And as I said in my lecture, at this moment, I bring the words of that great Dutch microbiologist Beiring 100 years ago, He said, happy are those who now start. That's what I say to this young generation. Go for it. All the best.
Thank you very much, Professor Reinaerts and Professor Verstraeten, and congratulations once again with your well-deserved honorary doctorate. I hereby end this special academic ceremony of handing out honorary doctorates on three eminent scientists and ask the mace bearer to escort the honorary supervisors and the honorary doctorates from the podium back to their seats. But before we do that and leaving the podium, we will take one picture with all the honorary doctors and the honorary promoters together here on stage. The audience, we are almost there, so I know you are getting thirsty, so am I. It's one more element we have to go through, and with much pleasure. I would like to invite to the floor our Dean of Research and the Chair of the Research Award Committee and member of the Board of the University Fund Wageningen, Professor Hendricks. Professor Hendricks.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's the final act of this DS celebration. It is my great pleasure to give you the winner of the research award funded by University Fund Wageningen. To recognize the accomplishment of our researchers within our organization, the University Fund Wageningen provides annual funding for a research award. This award aims to acknowledge groundbreaking discoveries and contributions to research in the past year by talented researchers of our organization and support them in their career. This year's evaluation committee consisted of three professors with widely differing areas of expertise who were asked to evaluate 13 nominations. A rather difficult task as the submissions covered a broad range of topics covering basically all our five science groups. However, the committee was nearly unanimous with number one, and number one, and a number two, so that's nearly unanimous, in the judgment that we have this year's winners in front of us. They chose to award the prize to a novel discovery of an important new mechanism, which was published in a top scientific journal and led to a patent application of which this year's winner is a co-author, and you can already see her sitting here. Her research is a prime example of how groundbreaking fundamental research can result in the development of applications and perfectly fits with the mission of our organization to explore the potential of nature to improve the quality of life. This year's winner of the University Fund Wageningen Research Award, and we also thank the Wageningen Graduate Schools for the committee, and awarding, nominating this year's winner is a PhD candidate working with Dr. Daan Swartz at the Laboratory of Biochemistry, and her name is Baldwina Kupal. I'll give you a microphone because I had the great idea. I contacted your co-promoter. I will put that over here for a minute. I contacted your co-promoter and I've written a whole speech about what you did. Then I thought, well, we've got you on the stage here, so my first question I can ask you, can you please explain in simple terms, because I read your cell paper and it's very difficult to read,
did you?
What you discovered. Yeah, it's turned on automatically.
It is?
Yeah. Huh. So can you please explain what you did in your cell paper that you published in 2022?
Yes. Yes, so let me take a look at what I did again. this paper is about short prokaryotic argonaut systems. And what the system is an immune system, but not for us, is for bacteria. So what can happen to bacteria is that they can get sick because like a virus can invade them. And just like us, they need mechanisms to defend themselves. And there's many, many, many of those systems available. And I was looking into this one, and it's a new one. And it consists of proteins. And what these proteins are able to do is that they can recognize the invader through its DNA. And what they will do then is they deplete, they destroy an essential metabolite in the cell. And what happens to the bacteria is that it dies. So that seems to be kind of a shit immune system, if it would be our immune system. But for them, it's actually quite beneficial, because when the bacterium dies, because it is infected, it cannot spread the infection anymore. So in this way, its neighbors are basically protected.
And the system, and system's called?
So we called it Sparta.
Sparta, yeah.
Sparta.
For the two proteins involved in that system.
Yes. So there is it's kind of illustrated there in the top left.
Well, I don't have to.
It's kind of difficult to explain in a minute.
It's very difficult to explain, but as you can understand, the committee had to read the 13 of these papers of different areas. But interesting, virtually unanimous decision came out. Your paper was number two in one, and for the other two,
I feel very honored.
Yes, it is a marvelous discovery. So, what was the most challenging part of the research for that paper?
So this is very easy answer for me. What is definitely the most difficult is finishing it. I think it's very easy to start things, and then finishing it is super hard.
It's a cell paper, which is quite amazing. How long before you graduate? How long?
So I expect to have my defense still this year. I will try to hand in my thesis this summer.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I specifically want to mention one thing. The promoter of Bell is Dolf Weijers. And Dolf Weijers was not on the paper with you, which is ethically very, very good in that sense. So, because he said himself he did not contribute to the science, and it was you and your supervisors and other team members. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think a rightful winner of this year's research award by the University Fund Wageningen. Congratulations.
Congratulations, Bel Kopal, with your rightly deserved final award. Maybe your first, but definitely not your last if you continue in this line. Ladies and gentlemen, with that, we have come to the end of this Dies Natalis, the 105th Dies Natalis of Wageningen University of Research. Thank you very much for coming here. I hope that you really got the key message. The marine environment is in need for further research and further protection also, if we indeed want to protect that and lead it into a sustainable development. We also invite you very much to the other activities during our lustrum year, which lasts until the start of the new academic year, so until, the 4th of September, I think. With that, we close this meeting, and I invite you to join us at the receptions downstairs. And as usually, normally, we first go out with the cortege, and then all the others follow. Thank you very much.